project called Everyday New Orleans, which we use, which you can see here, our mobile museum unit called NOMA Plus. I call her Ingrid, affectionately. So me and Ingrid have gone out to six different sites. These range from schools, community centers, so to a library. We also went to a homeless center. Have had some really impactful just conversations, sharing, and just projects. And all of those photos that were taken as a part of that were eligible to be displayed in the museum. These are the photos that you see here. So I guess I could just kind of pivot back a little bit, just give like my back, a little bit about myself. As I said, I'm from New Orleans. I've been involved, I grew up in a family of artists and art collectors, and just entrepreneurs. So I'm very passionate about culture, particularly New Orleans culture, history, and just using art to really transform community. So for me, when this opportunity arose to just be a part of this project, I was beyond excited. Because I just felt like it was a combination of a lot of what I'm passionate about. And I think it just is so revolutionary to really just change the way that museums interact with communities. Because a lot of people don't know just the disparity that occurs with just visitors of museums, museum staffs. There was a study in 2015 by the American Alliance for Museums that found only 9% of museum visitors are African American, only 6% are Latino. And they even did predictions that despite the fact that our country in 2033 will be 46% of people of color or more, they would still be only 9% of museum visitors. So with those facts, you know, museums really have to think about, okay, how are we gonna really transform how communities interact with museums? Because for years, institutions like these have excluded populations of people. So we use Ingrid to change that. I took this out to these six different sites, and it takes about 30, 40 minutes to assemble her and put her together, and she runs with by remote, so it's three different remotes that you press the button and it kind of comes down. It's very large, I think it's 14 feet high, I'm not sure how many feet wide. But yeah, everybody who sees it, they're just really amazed by it. And it's just really cool just to see people's reactions in addition to experiencing this workshop we gave to them. So at each of the sites, we did two workshops. So in the first workshop, we just did like an introductory, just kind of into what the project was, what photography is. We partnered with six different photographers whose names you can see on this wall as well. And they kind of just provide like just basic intros to photography on composition, angling, lighting, things like that. And then we explained the goal of the project. You know, we gave the students, with the students, we allowed them to use their phones. So we said, go out, you know, for a week and take whatever photos you want to show your everyday in an effort to combat stereotypes. So they went out, they took their photos, they came back, and in session two, we reviewed these photos and just talked about them and gave critiques. For Algiers, and the Regal Center. The Regal Center is a homeless center in New Orleans. We gave them disposable cameras. So a lot of these photos you see on this wall were actually taken with these cameras right here, which is really cool. I've actually become addicted to them myself since. I think it's really cool now to like take a photo but not know how it's gonna look until you go get it developed. I think it's really cool. You know, from these workshops, like I said, the second workshop we went and just kind of talked about each photo and talked about the stories behind them. And some of them were just really powerful. This photo here, this is from Esperanza Charter School. Esperanza is a majority, I think it's 60 or 70% Hispanic population school. And a lot of the students speak Spanish, obviously. And the photographer that we had there, Rolando, he's a Mexican artist, and so he was able to connect with the students and speak Spanish with them. But this one particular in this photo, this girl's name was Maya. So Maya, in workshop two, actually, this kind of shows like how I guess in teaching kind of have to go with the flow. They did not submit their, none of the students submitted their photos prior to workshop two. So like we get in the workshop, and it's like, okay, let's kind of make an audible. The audible that I gave was, okay, we're gonna get back into groups, and you all go outside, outside in the yard in the school, and you all, as a group, take photos and kind of with the intention of creating an exhibition for your group. So Maya, she was by far one of the most just excited students about the entire project. So her and her group, they were going around taking photos, and there was a period where she started, you can see in this photo, she started putting her friend's hair just around her face. Her friend had long braids. And I just remember like watching this happen. At one moment, she said, stop it, that's stupid. And I like went over and I said, yo, no, it's not stupid actually. I was able to show them this artist who actually was just an exhibition in this gallery prior to this one. Called A Queen Within. Now this is a French artist who obviously does these sculptures with braids. So for me that was just a very powerful moment just to show the connection between NOMA, what art is, and just what this project is about. We had just a lot of just different stories like that throughout the project. This photo, these two are from the Rebuild Center. As I said, it's a homeless center. This one is Justin Winfield, local artist. I actually ran into him in the French Quarter, I think 2 weeks ago, selling his art. He has four different photos in this display. And he was just, once again, just very excited about this project. This photo is from Lake Pontchartrain. He went to Lake Pontchartrain. He went to Lincoln Beach in New Orleans East. He also went to the old old Six Flags theme park, and just took just really amazing photos with this disposable camera. He got on top of old roller coasters and was taking photos, aerial shots. He's a little bit of a daredevil. Sarah, this story for me was really a really good one too. Part of Ingrid, as you can see, as I said, she's run by remote. So we were at Rebuild Center actually when I was leaving. We were having just like a mechanical issue. The ramp wasn't going up how I needed to. So I had to wait for the manufacturer to come. Sarah, I met her when I was passing out flyers for the workshop maybe a week prior to that. And she's also an artist and she was very excited to be a part of it. So I was looking forward to seeing her. But unfortunately that morning she was not a part of the workshop. So somewhat serendipitously, because of the malfunction I was having with the pop-up, she was walking past the gate that morning as I was waiting to leave. I was delayed to leave. And I was able to give her a disposable camera and she was able to take these photos. And Allison and I both said that this is one of the most profound photos in this entire display. And just to show that she took, some other amazing ones as well. But just to see that and just to give her that opportunity. And just to share herself and her view of the world. Rebuild was actually, I think they brought five different people on opening night, just to see how excited they were, just to be in this space. A lot of them was their first time in the museum. Just when we think about just how, culturally we use these identifications of race or class or sexuality to prevent us from sharing, connecting with people, and just to see how kind of this project kind of brings it all together. It doesn't matter if you're homeless, it doesn't matter if you're a student, it doesn't matter if you're an elder, you have the ability to just share your story. So I think that was the beautiful part about it for me, and I'm honored just to be a part of it and keep it going. That's a little bit about it. I think that's it. If anybody has any questions, I'm happy to answer. But this is everyday New Orleans.
Going to keep it going?
Yes, so in the fall our plan is to go into specific sites and have Ingrid rest at that site for a week and give artists opportunities to activate it however they wish around a central theme. So we're planning to start back up in September.
Do you have particular schools that you're going to be working with or programs?
They're not locked in yet. So if anyone, that's another thing. As community outreach coordinator, I mean, it is my role to create these partnerships. So if anyone knows of any organizations or places that are interested in this, I'd be happy to talk to you.
What about bringing people into the museum that you did through Everyday New Orleans? And how are you guys going to? And you bring it in actually on site,
everybody's... Yeah, so I mean, I think that's the additional layer of this. So everyone who participated in this, for the duration of the exhibition, they were allowed to come in. At each of these sites, we gave free passes, family passes. So just using this as a tool to say, you know, hey, like, not only you can come, but you and your family and whoever else you want to bring will come see this exhibition and also maybe see you on the wall. So I'm just using it as a bridge for that.
The community night on September
7th. Yes. So there will be a community night on September 7th. Any and everybody is free to come to the museum, and we'll have a panel talking about this project with some of the participants from it as well. So that will be September 7th.
Will Ingrid be set up?
Ingrid will be set up.
It
was just one day. I don't know. I guess this will probably show my personality a little bit. Because when she's closed up, she's not the most beautiful structure. Like somebody said that she looks like a police surveillance vehicle, which I think is hilarious. When I think of like the name Ingrid, I think of like, I don't know, like the European, rugby player who like churns butter with her father or something like that. But when she opens up, when you open her up, she's so beautiful. And you just have to go beneath the surface. So that's how I came up with that name.